Tobias works or is the head of software engineering for Schibsted and been working for Aftonbladet for quite a long time. So thank you, Tobias.
Yeah. So this talk is going to be less technical than some of the others, and I'll try to spill out some of the knowledge that we gathered around how to build a web performance culture in a company that is not the traditional technology company. So, with some nice background music to go. So I'm now moved to the managing side and I'm head of software engineering at Schibsted Publishing. That's part of the Schibsted Media Group. In Sweden, it's a lot of the internet companies like Blocket and Hitta and Prisjakt and almost all of the big sites in Sweden. Also big in the rest of Europe, like VG or Aftenposten in Norway, and stuff like Le Bon Coin and Segundo Mundo. But this talk is mostly going to be about Aftonbladet, which, for you, those of you who are not from Sweden, is actually one of the most successful news websites in the world today. It's the primary news source of the Swedish people. It has the same daily reach in Sweden as Facebook. And if you listen to the keynote earlier today, the funny thing is that Aftonbladet and Schibsted is now part of like the front runners for the fight for the open web against the internet giants like Facebook and Google and Apple and so on. So it's it has a quite unique position in the media landscape in the world, together with there are in very few countries that the media sites have so much direct traffic as in Sweden and in, like in Norway and just a few others. But this talk will be about performance, web performance. And as we all know, web performance is a really important technical concern for the systems that we're building. But I would say that this line of thinking about web performance as a technical thing, will not at all help you. It has to be treated as an important business concern. Because just having performance, if that doesn't mean anything to the business, then you're just spending resources on something that's kind of useless. So the only value out of your optimizations is that they actually help the business. Kind of, at least if you work for a for-profit company that has kind of exists for the sole purpose of doing business. And luckily, I happen to be in a company that I'm going to spill some internal secrets here from the Aftonbladet Online Product Strategy for 2015. Performance, and this is like the business side of things, the product strategy. Performance is at the core of all product decisions. And this is from a company that doesn't, it's not a technological company. The core of everything is the newsroom, earning money. And to understand how we got there, I'm going to start from the very beginning. And by that, I don't mean like in 1830 when Lars Johan Hierta stood on the streets and printing out, renaming the newspaper every time it was forbidden. But I'll start here. In the beautiful days of early web in 1994, when Aftonbladet got onto the web, and as we learned from the other Tobias, these are GIF images because JPEGs didn't exist back then in browsers. It actually has some really good performance characteristics, this page. And you can find it, it's still available on the web. And the articles there, they were great as Facebook instant articles if you want to do that. It looks awful in iOS Safari, but in all other browsers it works fine. And then, you know, from there on, stuff happened. Everything built organically on top of that. And the next big milestone in the history of web performance was in 2006, of course, when I was high. So when all the web performance movement, or if you want to call that, started, it was like in 2007 when Steve Savage's first book came out, and so on. We were in a situation where if you went into, I don't know which Google product that had that tagline, but we could see that Aftonbladet was slower than 98% of all websites in the world. So we kind of started from the rock bottom. and it makes sense because really big, complex news websites are kind of the worst case of web performance. You might have seen the slide earlier on and the third-party requests. That's probably a news website, I would guess. Lots of images, lots of third-party content from display advertisers and all kinds of other integration that you want to pull in, social media and stuff. So when you look at it now, I would say that you could use that, you could use us as a baseline. You should be able to, in 2015, to be at least as fast as Aftonbladet. If you're slower, you really should do a better job. We took this up as a kind of a challenge. Okay, we start from the bottom and we want to get up and try to do some incremental stuff to kind of increase the speed of the page. And the easiest way to do that was just to remove all the third-party content and optimize the stuff that you could control. That's probably how most people start off with optimizing stuff. The issue with that for a big website is that it's the third-party stuff that is kind of the problems. So the next big, really big milestone, or you could say the first, was in 2010, where we changed how ads are integrated into the page. We were quite early on with the whole non-blocking ads thing. This was implemented with the friendly iframe technique during 2009, 2010, and so on. And it was done. It was motivated on the sole motivation for it was to increase resilience. At that time, the ad networks were always a little shaky, and having them blocking the access to the rest of the page or to everything, showing just a big blank white screen, was deemed not acceptable. So we used that fact to change how we implemented ads. And that's kind of one of these things. If you want to do technical stuff that actually impacts the bottom line. I mean, ads were the like 95% of the incomes to Aftonbladet at that time, or whatever. It was huge. And changing how they worked on the page. And by in that case, in certain areas, we were actually reducing the value of these display ads because we didn't give them the complete full access to own everything on the page. We had to find some business motivated reasoning. And it was very successful. The page load time dropped 40%. Which kind of that's a cause for cake. At least if you work in my company, you always have cake. Every week we have cake. But it's kind of useless as a measurement. We have reduced page load time 40%, but what does that really mean? Well, from the A/B tests that we run, we were able to increase the visits per week per user with 7%, and the page views per visit by 18%. And now we're getting to something that's actually important because this impacts the business. We had a business that were really based on getting as many ad impressions as possible. That's how we made money. Okay. And improving page views per visits and visits per week, it has a really good impact on like the bottom line. Unfortunately, these were the tests from the A/B testing part. And when we actually deployed this in production, we had way less improvements. And I always think of these numbers whenever I hear someone showing numbers of how they improve stuff, that it's probably from the A/B testing. And you skip the rest. So what really helped us out here was that the sole motivation for doing this was to increase resilience. And the day that we deployed this was actually when we flipped it on for everyone was when one of the big ISPs in Sweden, I think it was Bredbandsbolaget, lost every connection to everything outside of Sweden. And our ad servers were in Germany. A lot of websites went total blank at that time. So we just flipped the switch and had everything except the ads load just fine. No, that's for the onload event. This was back in 2010 when people still cared about the onload event. So that's the actual onload event. So just increasing the parallelism in downloading stuff actually made it up to that. So based on that, we could continue. We had the kind of the business motivation for doing web performance. And we did that kind of in an incremental fashion, and unfortunately that's still how we have been doing it on the desktop site, at least up till now. But in 2012, we had the chance to rebuild the mobile experience that was kind of when mobile really took off. So we rebuilt the mobile site kind of from the ground up with performance as the core concern. Luckily for us, this was kind of just before everyone started to care about mobile. So we had pretty free hands on that. And the result was this graph, page views per visit. For like the last year, the editorial staff had tried to optimize how they built the website and to increase the recirculation to get people to stay longer and increase the page views per visit. And then we launched in April, or in might have been May. I took that little jump there, partly because we changed how we measured stuff. And then the real nice, like the textbook approach, it takes time for performance to actually pay off. Once you have learned that a website is slow, you still stay, it still stays slow for a long time after that. So a gradual increase in page views per visit. And this graph has helped us a lot because it shows, and it really got the company to understand that by doing technical stuff, we can do improvements that are leaps beyond what you can do with just the manual labor of the editorial stuff. So, performance is an important business concern. But how? How do you work with that? Missing question mark. Something that has worked really, really well for us when we set out to do something and set out to optimize. I mean, when you are to optimize something that's big and complex, you have to kind of cut it down to something that you really can understand, to identify the one most important thing and then optimize that first. So when we did the mobile site, this is like from some days ago, but it's pretty close to how it looked in 2013 conceptually. We looked at the site and decided, okay, what is the one most important thing on this site? And decided that it was to get that first ad on the screen as fast as possible without blocking out the content. As you know, ads are important for the bottom line, for the picture. But we can't let the ads block the experience. And unfortunately, when it comes to display ads, kind of the whole web performance journey that we have done from 2007 and 2015 has just gone way beside them all. The core of the display ad industry is still based around sending document rights and doing serial requests to a lot of different services, a lot of different DNS lookups, a lot of services that kind of they don't have keep alive enabled. And that's, we have to live with that. We have to accept that, and we can make ads as fast as possible. We actually did a concept in this case where we redid this first ad, because this is the ad that really has to be fast. We redid that to a new ad format that loaded as fast as it was possible with the ad service that exists, and it had really good impact. It actually had really good numbers too, but it was impossible to sell because the ad buying side of the business, they're also not there right for web performance. So we had to revert that, and we were still hoping to jack it in someday. But understanding that this is the most important part helped us tremendously in how we were to prioritize stuff. We of course didn't. We wanted that critical rendering path to be as short as possible, but we also had to kind of inline the stuff that needed just to load that one ad, and then the other ads, they could wait for some other stuff to happen. So identifying that one most important thing, and if that is related to the business of your company, that helps. The other thing that is really important is that this is an area where we're on the web. Things are moving fast. So we did some really kind of groundbreaking work on that website in 2013. I did some talks. We wrote articles and also in a book. That article on Smash Magazine is kind of fun. They wanted to name it "Solving the Responsive Image Performance Problem," but we were kind of Swedish, so we could settle for addressing the responsive image performance problem. And kind of that whole solution and that article, like 50% of this is just void now because we now have the picture element, and also some of these other stuff that we really did for this website. I mean, this was almost 3 years ago, so a lot of stuff has happened since then. So the best practices then are not necessarily the best practices now, and not being attached to your wonderful solution is really core to the performance culture, building an interest for trying out something new, and just realizing that everything that you have ever built is probably crap. At least if it's not crap now, it will be crap in the future. So, the other really important thing here for this whole performance as a business concern regards to metrics. We need to have some numbers to work on. And to have those, we don't just need numbers. We need some actionable metrics that matters. As I said, when we started back in the days, we had kind of the onload event and the page load time. That was the only kind of metric that we had, and that's why we optimized for that. And then we realized that metric was kind of, that didn't mean anything, or very, very little. So we had to find other metrics. Earlier today, we mentioned stuff like the speed index, which I think is really great in theory. But when you have a above the fold that looks like this, you realize that when you want to measure when everything on this page has loaded, you see that it's mostly not controlled by us. So you get these big variations in the page in the speed index value. So then you have two different options. You can either just, okay, we don't care about these third-party stuff. We test it without them, or we test it with some reference images. Or we just give up and look at something else. And in our case, it has been really useful to instead define our own metrics and look at use and timings and custom metrics and to look at if the most important thing is how fast can we get that ad on the screen. That's the metric that we should use and that we should track. Also, once you have these numbers, you really, really want to make them visible. So big screens everywhere, having them in emails to important people. But you also want the less important numbers to be less visible. I actually picked that screen there because of that screen, which is taken from our internal web page test, that shows a lot of really interesting stuff, but no one actually looks at it because it just shows too many numbers in the same way. So it's really hard to know if you don't know what each is, which one is the most important, what should I look at, and what should I do about it. So making the less important numbers less visible is actually just as important to get the business side of things to make these metrics actionable. And also, when you work in a company that is not purely a technical company, you really want to use metrics that make sense to normal people. And in this case, normal people are journalists, editors, working on writing articles, reporting news, doing the stuff that they really care about. And then having them starting caring about asset weights and stuff like element count on the page, that's really tough. But we found out that the combined asset weights and the number of images and the number of DOM elements on the page is really, really important for us. So what we did was we actually kind of found something that correlates to that, which is the page length in pixels of the editorial area without the ads. That's really understandable for someone who works on this. And can you take action on this metric? Once the alarm sounds that the page is too long, yes, I'll just remove a bunch of stuff from the bottom of it. At this point in time, the front page was kind of like fully manually managed. So to get to the real issue, which is the assets weights, the number of images, the number of DOM elements on the page, we actually had to invent this kind of weird metric of the length of the page that we measure continually and send an alarm once it passes the magic threshold. And we try to avoid discussions about why we can't add 200 pixels more to that threshold. There were actually a time when the actual page length has had a significant impact in some versions of Chrome on desktops with the Retina screens. But other than that, the number of pixels actually isn't that important. The other thing that I really, really think is important if you want to get this into the core of your business is to make sure that you integrate the performance metric into the analytical tools that other people use. And in this case, in our case, the other people, that is the kind of the analysts, the analytics departments, who are working in tools like Adobe Analytics or something. Because otherwise, it's very easy that the real user monitoring stuff, that's the technical measurements. But it's when you can combine that with the other business data to find out what's most important for the recirculation values. Is it the page load time, or is it that the user is actually interested in sports or whatever is on this page? And so on. And to get these important metrics onto the same dashboard and onto the same reports as everything else is really powerful. So I would really encourage you to try to get as much as possible into the same tools that are used for analytics, for other types of analytics. And if that's impossible, you should at least try to get them to change the tools. So basically, what web performance all comes down to is that you try to find the best option that exists today. This was actually what in kind of 2009, I think, where I had a discussion with Steve Saunders when he was here. And that was his advice, and I kept it with me. At that time, it was putting ads into iframes, friendly iframes. But there are really two key elements of this. It's that we should find the best option. That doesn't mean that it's necessarily a great option. When you have to deal with third parties, stuff that's out of your control, when you have to balance different concerns, you will most likely land in compromises. But that's good. We're Swedish, right? So you should strive for finding the best option that you can do. And come back to what I said earlier, the best option that exists today. And it will probably not be in the future, like now that HTTP2 is coming, there are a lot of stuff that we really have to just relearn. And also, to really get this going inside your company, what you need is you need to create a performance culture everywhere. But to be able to uphold that, you need to have some spearheads or some like the internal performance gurus that can drive this. And when you are optimizing, don't just take everything that is said on the presentation like this for granted. What we have found out is that a lot of the stuff, the best practices, a lot of these kind of measurements, they might not apply to your situation. If you have a website that is just the typical ordinary, very small website, you can go for whatever rules are written by someone else. But if you live in a complex world, you really have to find your own way forward. So don't blindly just trust the experts on this, which includes don't trust me. And and look at how you can build a culture within your company that can be really good for the web performance. If, and only if, that's also good for the business. So I think it all comes down to starting with you. I guess you're mostly technical people in here. Starting to think of how will web performance impact the business and go from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Tobias. So, do we have any questions?
Hi. Tobias, you mentioned the page length here.
Yeah.
Page length. Isn't that something that you can work around by lazy loading content? Like instead of making requests for all the images in the page, maybe lazy loading them, and then as you scroll down, you make requests for the content that you're not rendered yet?
Yes. The kind of interaction that we have on Aftermarket is really very much a click at an article, read an article, go back to the page. And the back issue, at least before, had really, really problems with finding where you are on the page if you rely too much on lazy loading and so on, so stuff. So we had those kinds of issues that we when we did the experimentation, then we found out that lazy loading was actually added too much trouble for it to be worth it.
Okay, so I have one question. So Tobias, how do you highlight like the most important metrics you use? Because you showed a graph you had, but you had a lot of things, and you said you need to highlight the ones and make the not so important, not so visible. How do you actually do that?
Yeah, we have other screens too, showing some of these numbers currently. Most of our metrics have been built on custom-made stuff that runs things on weird servers. So we made these screens with the important numbers really big. We got them put up on the newsroom floors, and we now are working on integrating all kinds of metrics into the some shared dashboards that you also, when you look at, okay, how many Aftonbladet, how much Aftonbladet Plus did we sell today? You can also find the important metrics from the web performance parts. So. We're kind of redoing that as we speak. So.
Okay. Perfect.
Hi. So from basically a metrics standpoint, do you put it in the hands of the business to decide and present which key metrics you guys need, or do you try to influence the business side by kind of, you know, leaning or, you know, targeting specific metrics that are easier for you guys to work with to basically be able to do more work around performance?
Yeah, we actually have analytics persons, the web analysts within our development teams. So to really not have to do that kind of discussions. And I think that's really great. Because it is so very closely related. They need us, we need them. We actually now have the web analysts driving a project to just reduce the analytics scripts on the page. The number of tracking scripts on the page, they want to get rid of everything but one or two. So that's also something that I would really, really recommend if you can, to inside your agile-ish teams, get a analyst people there. They don't need to be full-time, but a dedicated person to the team.
Okay, thank you.